This is the Hexadder, made in 1971 by Hexco Inc. in Houston, Texas. It has 6 columns of digits with input locations 0 through 9, and then A, B, C, D, E, F. Same thing down here, but it's red. I have the original stylus, which clips in the side here. It has add hex, sub hex, clear. On the back, it has tables for hexadecimal conversion. Return to CDP? I don't wanna. The Hexco company still exists today. These days, it's sort of a general education publishing company. They sell a lot of stuff to help kids prepare for competitive spelling bees. But in the 1970s, Hexco was in the hexadecimal business. Very niche gadgets for hardcore computer engineers. This little guy was sent to me by faithful viewer Tom Carlson. It really means a lot to me that folks would send me something. Thank you, Tom! The hexadecimal number system is different from our ordinary base 10 numbers, so maybe we should do a little review of positional number systems. Most human beings throughout history have thought of numbers as organized into groupings of 5 and 10. Roman numerals have special symbols for 5, 10, 50, 100. The Maya numerals have dots representing 1s and lines representing 5s. Chinese counting rods are similar. The Chinese abacus has some beads representing 1, some representing 5, and each column represents place values of 1s, 10s, 100s. The Russian abacus gets rid of the 5s entirely, but still each row is a place value. The Inca quipu has different knots representing 1s plus place value by powers of 10. And of course there's the Hindu Arabic number system. We have individual memorized symbols for 0 through 9, and the place value in terms of 10s is determined by the position. It's a base 10 positional number system. To me, this is one of the great achievements of the human intellect. But it is, in the end, a human cultural invention. Human beings like 5s and 10s, probably because most of us have 5 fingers on 2 hands, so we like to write numbers that way. But this is just our own cultural choice. If we ever encounter, like, aliens with different anatomy from us, they might count in terms of 4s and 8s, or maybe 6s and 12s. There's no real reason to prefer a specific base rather than any other. But when you're making a computer, there really is a preferred base to use, and it's not 10, it's 2. See, in a base 10 system, each digit has 10 possible values, like 10 shades of gray per digit. I count 0 up to 9, and then after 9, I carry over to the next digit. This works great for people, but computers don't operate with shades of gray. Everything is just black or white, not 10 gradations, just 2 gradations. That means that when a computer counts, it has to be like this. Each digit is just 0 or 1, but you carry in the same way. Looks a little crazy, but it actually works just fine. The big hassle from a human point of view is that binary numbers are really big when you write them on paper. Here, let's count together. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. In binary, the number 8 is already a 4-digit number. So people came up with a standard shorthand for this. We make groupings of 4 bits each and represent each group as a single digit. And the problem with that is you run out of digits. Binary 1001 is 9, but then how do we represent the next number as a single digit? You gotta just invent new ones. So we use A for 10, B for 11, all the way up to F for 15. And this weird system with single digits 0 through F is called hexadecimal. So a big long binary number like this would be represented by this much shorter looking hexadecimal number. Still means the same number, it's just written in a more convenient way. So the hex system is just a shorthand for binary, or you could think of it as its own base 16 number system. 16!
That's a lot of base.
These days, ordinary people don't interact with hex data directly, but if you work with computers a lot, you might see hex numbers used every so often. A network MAC address is a string of 12 hex digits. HTML color codes are made up of 6 hex digits, but mostly all the data in your computer gets automatically converted to some more human-friendly format before you ever see it. Of course, it wasn't always like that. In the early days of computing, computer operators would pretty often have to work directly with hex data. This would include doing arithmetic, like if you're looking in memory register AF95 and you see an instruction to jump forward by this many registers, where should you end up? Well, you got to add those 2 numbers. This takes some getting used to, but you can work it out by hand. I go 5 plus 1 is 6, Then 9 plus 3 is 12, which in hex is C. Then F plus 8, that's 15 plus 8, which is 23, which splits as a 16 plus a 7. So I write 7 and then carry a 1. Then 1 plus A plus 1, that's 1 plus 10 plus 1, which is 12, which is C. There you go. And here finally is where we arrive at the Hexadder, a handheld instrument for doing exactly this kind of addition. Let's just try that same addition here on the Hexadder. I enter the first number, AF95. You just stick the stylus in the holes and pull down each time. You can enter them left to right or right to left, doesn't matter. All right, now I'm going to enter the other number. I'm going to go right to left this time. First is 1. I grab the 1 and pull down. Then I got a 3. Same thing. Now the 8 is interesting because there's going to be a carry. I see the hole for the 8 is red. That's your signal that you're going to have to carry. And you do this by sliding up instead of down. And go around the bend at the top, which does the carry. Isn't that cute? Then my last digit is a 1, and I'm all done. Once you get used to it, this is very easy to use. When you're in the silver zone, you slide down. When you're in the red zone, you slide up and carry. The lower half of the machine is used for subtraction. Like this subtraction would look like this. I enter C7C6 on the positive side, and then subtract AF95. There you go. This thing is obviously inspired by the very popular Addiator. I made a video about that one. The folks at Hexco looked at the Addiator and realized, hey, all you got to do to change the bass is stretch out these sliders a little bit. Bass 16 for free. It's pretty remarkable to me that human beings really have to stretch to work in hexadecimal. Shifting your brain from bass 10 to bass 16, or really any other bass, it's not easy at all. You got to like rewire your whole brain and practice a lot to get good at it. But how do you convert a bass 10 machine to a bass 16 machine? It's easy. Just make this thing a little bit longer and it works. The Hexadder overall looks and plays exactly like the Addiator, except for the clearing mechanism. On the Hexadder, to reset everything to zero, you grab this thing with the stylus, pull up and then back down. This is very satisfying to do. The feel of the stuff sliding around in there and the clickety-clackety sound is great. But I'm not sure why they changed it from the Addiator. On the Addiator, you grab this bar with your fingers and pull it up. Both are great designs, but I like the Addiator a little bit more. My boy Tom was nice enough to include the original plastic sleeve with the original instruction sheet. Instructions get their own sleeve on the back, which is great. On the Addiator, you have to put them in the same sleeve, so when you let your kids play with it, they rip the instructions. Good idea, Hexco. Unfortunately, the Hexadder can't do one of the most common tasks that a person would want to do, convert back and forth from hex to base 10. They give you some helpful charts on the back, but they're not making any promises. Hex values can generally be converted to decimal by use of the conversion table and pencil arithmetic. Well, I appreciate the honesty. So now I guess I got my base 10 Addiator and my Hexadder. I'm ready for anything. I remember when I was a kid, I was a bit fascinated by numbers in other bases. Like, I knew something about ordinary numbers, but there's a whole other universe of other kinds of numbers. Base 2, base 12, base whatever. And who knows what we might discover when we start to look at those numbers. But I was actually off base a little. Base. These different bases aren't other kinds of numbers. They're really the same numbers, just written differently. The whole base thing is just a cultural choice we make. A social construct, as the academics would say. The number 27 looks like this, a 2 and a 7. But that's not what the number 27 really is. The 2 and the 7 is a description of the number 27 in base 10, but in base 5, it's 102. In base 2, it's 11001. There's tons of ways to write it. You could even do base pi if you want to get crazy. These are all different ways to represent the number, but none of them is the number. And I imagine myself as a kid asking, okay then, what really is the number 27? If it's not a 2 and then a 7, then what is it? Well, it is something, at least in my mind. But as a mathematician, I don't worry about what it really is. I just tell you about it. You know, like the way I'd tell you about my mom or my best friend. I don't tell you what it is, but I tell you what it's like, what it can do, what we can do together. Like 27, I mean, yeah, it's a 2 and a 7, but it's also like a 1 and a B. I mostly think about it like this. But it can also do this, or maybe this, and also this, eh? The 2 and the 7, see, they only tell you a tiny part of the story. And is there any more of that story? Well, yeah, there's more. There's always more.